Much of the GMO debate revolves around science. Either we as a society know what we need to know about the technology and its products, that is, there's a consensus on which we can base our policy and our personal decisions, or we do not. Debates continue around the science of both the utilities and the risk of GMOs. Risk, in particular, make for especially powerful politics. For example, we do not want pharmaceutical drugs on the market before there's a solid scientific consensus that they're safe and effective. We don't want excessive risk. The same would be true for vaccinations for children or taxes on carbon to head off global warming. In each case, we want to be in tune with the scientific consensus. Now, at the global level, climate science has reached a consensus that is institutionalized by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. On climate change, the consensus has been building, often against stiff opposition. Over 97% of published articles that expressed a conclusion about anthropogenic climate change endorsed human-caused global warming. Not just the number of articles, then, though. It's more important that there are no national or major scientific institutions anywhere in the world that dispute the theory of anthropogenic climate change. So one good measure of consensus is the weight of good evidence and legitimation by independent and competent institutions that have the requisite expertise and no axes to grind. So moving on to GMOs, either there is a similar settled consensus, or there may be too many disagreements about the science, and or there may be significant risk in what we do not know. We'll now ask, what is a scientific consensus, and does it matter in politics? As someone who's not a scientist, I have the perspective of a citizen interested in public welfare and safety. Of special importance, I want institutions that govern potential risk to be firmly rooted in scientific consensus. In the U.S., for example, the Food and Drug Administration makes decisions about the safety of pharmaceuticals doctors can prescribe. I then trust my doctor who trusts the FDA. Think of this consensus as institutionalized science or official science. How is such a consensus arrived at? Well, first, it's a slow process of weeding out errors in our understanding of the world until scientists who know the field agree. Second, this is a slow process and it may be contentious. There's always a fringe or opposition, and there will be turmoil. For centuries, for example, the consensus that the Earth revolves around the sun rather than vice versa was intensely disputed, and minority position, which we now all believe, was persecuted by religious authorities who disagreed on theological grounds, not science. Likewise, the germ theory of disease was long rejected and is still questioned in many social settings, seen now in the rejection of vaccinations as a safe way to prevent illness. The global consensus on climate change likewise has many dissidents, though fewer and fewer scientists over the years. To summarize, a scientific consensus first depends on agreement about the scientific method itself, and that means evidence-based propositions tested by means that can be replicated by other researchers in a transparent system. Second, a scientific consensus will be based on the best available, high-quality evidence. Third, it will have survived challenges. Consider the theory of evolution. It makes very strong evidentiary claims that would be easy to refute if there were new evidence, but so far these claims have stood up to the new evidence. Still, there are many puzzles in evolution and new challenges all the time as new evidence emerges. So I think of the consensus as a center of concentric circles. The core is solid, but as we move outward from the core, there is more ambiguity about specifics. We all believe in a theory of gravity. If you drop a rock, it falls. But not all the mechanisms of the theoretical level are sorted out. We don't stop believing rocks will fall just because physicists debate string theory. So, is there a scientific consensus on GMOs? Not in the same sense as the global institutionalized science of climate change produced by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. There is no comparable international body. But there are comparable national bodies, and their consensus does converge on the conclusion of the American Association for the Advancement of Sciences. This is their statement. And I quote, "The science is very clear. Crop improvement by modern molecular techniques of biotechnology is safe. The World Health Organization, the American Medical Association, the U.S. Academy, National Academy of Sciences, the British Royal Society, and every other respected organization that has examined the evidence has come to the same conclusion. Consuming foods containing ingredients derived from GM crops is no riskier than consuming the same foods containing ingredients from crop plants modified by conventional plant improvement techniques. We'll post the PDF of this statement in the Dive Deeper section. So why should we trust such statements? The American Association for Advancement in Science, first of all, publishes one of the most universally prestigious journals in the world, Science. It is the largest and considered by many to be the most prestigious association of scientists, but it is American, and many people around the world think of biotechnology as being especially favored in the U.S. So let's look elsewhere. And to avoid contamination of national prejudice of Americans who are relatively comfortable with risk, or contamination by corporate power that puts a thumb on the science, we look to the European Commission Directorate General for Research. This is a report they've done that's called A Decade of EU-Funded GMO Research, and this is their conclusion from this very large study. The results and conclusions of these projects increase our accumulated knowledge, enabling the Commission and policymakers in general to contribute to the international debate and to provide scientific support to regulatory frameworks and initiatives. The main conclusion to be drawn from the efforts of more than 130 research projects, covering a period of more than 25 years of research, and involving more than 500 independent research groups, is that biotechnology, in particular GMOs, are not per se more risky than, for example, conventional plant breeding technologies. These statements go to one way we should look at this, the consensus. First, they both rely, that is, the statement from the American Association for the Advancement of Sciences and the EU Directorate General for Research, they rely on a technique called meta-analysis. Since individual studies differ in design and not all are comparable, there will always be peer-reviewed articles that are outliers from the general trend. These outliers can be emphasized in a process that we call cherry-picking to disestablish central evidence in the field. A meta-analysis typically takes all the peer-reviewed work that's been published, sometimes even non-peer-reviewed work for comparison, to see where there is a convergence of evidence and analysis. The EU meta-analysis we looked at is especially broad-ranging and avoids the taint of either industry-funded science that we often hear about and American bias, which is relatively more risk-accepting. Does this consensus matter in the GMO debate? Well, not necessarily. First, science by its very nature is inherently incomplete and tentative, always subject to revision by new evidence. Therefore, it is politically and socially vulnerable to several kinds of objections. One objection is that scientists disagree, so a statement about safety can be rejected on grounds of a few exceptions to the consensus, even if these are based in very weak or fringe science. Second, science tells us nothing at all about appropriate risk preference. Consider vaccine and the autism scare. Some parents may think that even the tiniest risk of so horrible an outcome as autism is sufficient to prevent their children from being vaccinated. Despite the consensus that autism is not caused by vaccines, the numbers of anti-vaxxers, as they're called in the United States, have increased dramatically from campaigns in social media and internet placements with consequences for public health. Both cherry-picking and fringe science are especially prominent on the internet and often appear more prominently than serious science. You can Google and find out. You'll see it very quickly. The authorities quoted in much of the fringe science, though, have no or dubious credentials in the field in which they claim expertise. My personal rule of thumb is that of Carl Sagan, the astrophysicist. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. This means demanding a lot of an article that claims stunning results contrary to established consensus. That vaccines cause autism, for example, or that BT cotton drives Indian farmers to suicide. The best we can do as science consumers and citizens is to look to, first, peer-reviewed science in the best journals and especially to meta-analyses that cover the entire field. As the information costs of doing this are very high for most of us, and we have different tolerance for risk, those unknown unknowns, political controversy over science is inevitable, even consensual science. This is one reason there are differences across individuals and countries in acceptance or rejection of GMOs. We will explore in a future section these social dynamics of science diffusion and science communication.